All right, there he is, Safid. It was ugly, but at least it was a victory, right? Because the Chargers had an ugly game and they lost.
The Chargers lose every game they play, man. They suck. The Chargers suck.
Right?
Yes. The Chargers find a way to lose every game, and the Dolphins find a way to hold on in this one. Look, we are very spoiled as Dolphins fans here. 422 yards, and you're questioning the offense in this one, right? Even Mike McDaniel said, you know, hey, we raised the standards, and that's right. When you go out and score 70 points, and then you only put up 21 points, right? Was it 21? Barely. So, 20%. You know, so, yeah, so when you put up 70 points and then put up 20, it looks like a dud, but you win the game, and that's all that matters at the end of the day.
Yeah, to me, it was more about the turnovers, the bad decisions. Those are the things that Tua, bro, stop diving forward, dude. What the hell is wrong with you? Slide.
Yeah, Tua's always going to be himself and play like that.
Yeah, but you're gonna blow your shoulder out, an elbow, or jam a wrist, or fumble. You know, slide and there's no fumble, and whether you get the first down or not, who cares, bro? You dive when it's the end of a game. You dive when it's the playoffs. You dive when it's the Super Bowl. Not in the early part of a game that doesn't mean shit at that moment.
Yeah, there's a bunch of things here. You know, Mike going for it on fourth and fourth and one, where Tyreek got hurt. You know, they could have kicked the field goal there. I understand why they went for the points and they messed up. They could have kicked the field goal there and tied it up there. And then I questioned Mike about, you know, going for it on 5 seconds left at the end of the half. And Tua holds onto the ball way too long. Then he gets drilled in the back. You know, just a bad execution at that point, too. I understand where Mike is coming from, because when I saw the Dolphins do that at halftime against the Chargers, and it was the reason why they won the game, it was just much more better execution. They also had more time on the clock. This one was just 5 seconds. Like, take the knee and realize, you know, you can just get out of here. You know, I think the Dolphins were going to be in trouble this game. You know, when you lost Achan in the first quarter and then Hill got hurt, you're worried about the whole prospect of the whole season right there, right? And we'll see. I mean, they still have to do an evaluation on Achan. Mike did say that they had a good evaluation or heard great from them, from the medical team, but they didn't want to push him, you know, towards to come back in this game. You know, not sure if he's going to play on Friday against the Jets. And not sure who knows what's going to come back after they really, really evaluate him on Monday, or, you know, Monday morning as the week gets started.
Well, with Achan, I think they're going to have to pace him a little bit more and not give – I think it became so enticing because he was producing at a sick rate. Maybe they've – you know, because from what I remember – The talk was a 5 to 10 carry guy, and then all of a sudden it became a lot more than that. And I think that maybe what they have to do is pace the kid a little bit more and have him be more of a, you know, part of a group of running backs instead of being maybe the focal point with Mostert.
Yeah, no, Mostert has to be the focal point here. He's the most healthy one right now. And like you said, the fact that they had such good success with him, you can obviously see why they want him back. I mean, Achane is going to be the X factor for the rest of this year, regardless of, you know, how it kind of shakes out. You want to know what you have in him when he comes back, and hopefully there's a really good return on, you know, if he does MRI or something after the game, you know, for Monday morning. Mike McDaniel pretty much said that, you know, the second drive, I believe, in the game, he kind of got rolled over a little bit. Landed on, and then after that moment it was kind of all right, let's take him out, and then they kind of got an encouragement word on him. Achan had his helmet in the second half, came out with it when and he didn't have hold his helmet at all at the end of the first half. So something to keep an eye on for sure. You're just hoping an MRI comes back clean on that, and you know, I don't even know about the Jets game, because that turf over there at MetLife is still something to worry about when it comes to knee injuries and things like that. So I can understand the guys have to play. It's a tough game. They're going to be on TV, you know, just them by themselves on a Friday afternoon. But, you know, we'll see how the Dolphins do this week. This is a big week for the Dolphins coming up. It was good to get their feet wet again in the game. It was good to, you know, get back on the field after pretty much, you know, 2 weeks without, you know, since their last game. But things are going to ramp up really quickly for them this week.
let me ask you. So you see lately, and you know I'm a big Tua guy, but lately he's had too many turnovers.
Yeah.
So and it's kind of like I was talking about this. Confident athletes, they have a confidence that most of us don't have unless we're doing what we normally do, whatever it is in our walk of lives. I don't care if it's washing cars. I don't care if you're an architect. I don't care if you're a broadcaster. I don't care if you're a salesperson, whatever. If you're good at what you do, you're going to have this extra level of confidence that you can do things that other people can't. So is it more about confidence? Is it more about being irresponsible a little bit? Maybe he is not, you know, maybe he's not taking care of the football the way he's supposed to. Or what is your theory on why Tua lately has been a little irresponsible with the football?
When you see Steph Curry pull up from 45, 50, right, and he makes it, there's no reason why you question it, right?
Right.
Because you know what the guy can do when he makes it. So Tua and the Dolphins just scored 70 points on offense. We literally spoke about all offseason how Tua doesn't have confidence, right? And the offense and things like that. It just happened to come in the last year with Mike McDaniel here. The first 2 years of his career, he's been told to not turn the ball over. And now he's been told to take shots down the field and see what you have here. And look who they have. He's throwing a Waddle and Hill, man. Two of the best receivers. One of the best receiver combos.
Okay, but where Waddle is surrounded by three people, you may not want to throw that ball, bro.
And sometimes you want to let it fly, too. Sometimes you want to let it fly, too. I support it. I support it because of the fact that look at where this kid came from, man. We were not having him throw the ball here. He was not throwing the ball here when he was doing this, things like that. You know what I mean? He was told to not turn the ball over, and then it made him timid. There's no more timid into it now. You used to worry about it. You used to see Ryan Fitzpatrick would come into the game and be like, man, it's so cool to see Devontae Parker and Mike Gesicki getting an inch of separation and getting the ball because the ball was thrown to him. Now you have Tua Tagovailoa trying to throw guys open and trying to make some things in some windows that he knows can fit in certain windows at certain times. Those plays that you're talking about where Waddle's, you know, surrounded by three players, you know, those are plays that have worked for them in the past. So if Waddle, you know, if Tua thinks he can throw it in a keyhole, you know, by all means, let him, you know, let him make those plays. Let him make those mistakes. He rebounds after mistakes more than, you know, better than any other person that we've seen when they do turn the ball over. And you know what? This is a team that they can get it against. You know what I mean? The Dolphins knew what they had on the other side of the football there. The Raiders don't scare you, right? Their quarterback situation doesn't scare you or anything like that. No. You know, that's why they kind of played toward the hand of that. That's why Mike is kicking field goals in the second half and they only got 6 points. You know, they played to the defense in this one and got out of it with a win.
Is Mike McDaniel still giving up on the run too much?
Like why would you say that?
The third and short?
Fourth and short? I think
I think by now, do we know that the Tyreek screen thing doesn't work? He fumbled last week and you got him injured this week. Smythe couldn't block it, and now Craycraft couldn't block it. So why do you keep running the same stupid play that doesn't work when you can just hand it off to him?
Yeah, that play has worked in the past, so I can see why they go to it. That situation in particular, I just wish they would have kicked the field goal and tied the game.
Okay.
You know, sometimes you got to live to play another down, live to play another series. I mean, it was early in the game. You know, they had just had a field goal over you. Like, you know, I can understand why you want to go for seven. I can understand why, you know, everything, all the thinking behind it, right? Even if you mess up, the defense can, you know, take the field over on that. And, you know, the Raiders didn't really do much with that after that, I believe, right? Did they score after that sequence?
I don't think so.
I'm not sure, but, you know, that's kind of where you hope they take a smarter thing. I think Mike having that play fourth and one, I can understand why he went for it. But just, like, kick the field goal and come back and score seven on the next drive, right? Come away with points. Don't not leave points on the table. And then when I look back at the end of the first half, that was my big situation there. You know what? I'm happy that they did what they did with Jason Sanders in this half as well, too. You know, missed the field goal, kicked the field goal, kicked another field goal. You need to have your field goal kicker. And if Mike was going to make a play call and ice Jason Sanders, that could be detrimental for him for the rest of the season, too. So I kind of like the fact that Mike kind of, you know, was patient and played to the defense a little bit in the second half there.
What do you do about the kicker?
You trot him out there and have him keep kicking, man. trot him out there and have him keep kicking. Look, he missed one from 50 and hit the next one from 51. You know, you have to treat him like you treat Tua.
I'd like to dig around the building and find out what was the reasoning why they kept his ass.
He had a great year one year. What was that, 2020? Had a great year.
Yeah, but that was a long time ago already.
Yeah, this is the end of the contract for the last
year and a half. Man, it's just, brother, he just doesn't look like you can trust him.
Yeah, Jason Sanders is a really quirky case. You know, I liked him when he was with who's the old special teams coach here that we loved, man?
Oh, yes, Rizzo.
Darren Rizzi. Loved him with him. He was with Rizzi, with this guy, I'm not sure. But look, the right things happened in this game for him. He missed one, and they didn't call a play to take him away from kicking again. In fact, he kicked two more field goals, and he nailed both of those opportunities right down the middle. So you have to work with it. You have to work with it.
All right. By the way, Steve M has a question for you on Venmo. He said, over the last four games, Eagles, Pats, KC, and today, how many of those were off games versus good games? And he's talking about Tua. And Safid, did he bounce back after his deep interception against Philly? He didn't score a TD in the entire second half today. What are you talking about, dude? He usually plays better after an interception.
That's what I said, too. Yeah. Look, you're talking about a four-game window here where, you know, they didn't light it up, yeah? Okay, but and are we giving them too high expectations because they lit it up in the Broncos game? Yeah, definitely we are. And look at the games that they won in that span, right? Let me pull up the schedule here. What was the games again that you said? Chiefs, Eagles, last four, right?
Yes.
Yeah, and what do you come out with? 2-2, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he said Eagles, Pats, KC today.
Yeah, you're playing the last two teams that went to the Super Bowl and then two cupcake teams. So being 2-2 out of that, not fine. You know, we're obviously where you kind of come up short against the Super Bowl teams. You know, they're a lot more physical than you. They can stop the run, and when they slow down the run, you don't know what to do from an offensive standpoint. So when you look at the whole envelope of things, I like I told you before, I want to see the operation get better. They're about to go to the Jets game on Friday, and who knows how loud that place will be. But getting the operation together, getting things a lot more smoothly and called correctly and communicated well, you know, those are things that I want to see. And, you know, you have to beat the teams that are in front of you. They haven't beat the teams that the Chiefs and Eagles when they played them. So be it. You know, you have the rest of the season here to really improve and figure out what's going on and how to toughen up a little bit to play better down the stretch of the season when you play better games. Like, you know, you're going to have the Cowboys, Ravens, and Bills in the final three. So still plenty of football left to play, but still you're hoping to get another win this week against the Jets. This is a big week too. You know, the Jets are not something to be slept on. Their offense is, but not that defense.
No, definitely not. Just watching Zach the MILF Wilson throw an interception now. All right.
What's his name? I missed that. What was
Zach,
his name?
Zach the MILF Wilson.
Okay.
Yeah.
I like that. Hey, that's a good day.
He's the MILF hunter, man. What do you got, Sean? Well,
Rich Simeone put out a stat on Zach Wilson.
Oh.
Season pass attempts and TD passes. He's done 306 attempts, 5 touchdowns. Tommy DeVito, 73 attempts, 5 touchdowns.
Nice.
Yeah. Mid and mid. That's why the reason the Raiders lost today, because they didn't face those two guys.
That's right. That's right. All right. What do you got going on in the USA today?
Yeah, I'm going to be definitely checking out the Devin A-Chain thing tomorrow with them. Obviously, going to be working I'll be home, but Friday, looking forward to working that game from home here in Miami. We'll see, man. Tyreek Hill had something really great to say about Jalen Ramsey, that the way he extended and got that interception at the end of the game, then got the ball knocked out of him. You know, game on the line. You know, that was the play right there. If Ramsey didn't go up and get it, who knows if the other guy would have. You know what I mean? We could have had a tied game, went to overtime, have another different conversation here. But on day when the offense left a lot to be desired and, you know, Tua was turning the ball over, they didn't light him up like we all thought they were going to. Jalen Ramsey was the brightest star on the field.
No doubt. So, only guy better than Jalen would have been Noah Igbinoghamy. That's it. Mm-hmm. Outside of that, nobody else would have been able to do what Jalen did. Noah, yes, but, you know, it is what it is. Follow him on Twitter at Saffid_Dean. Saffid, as always, thank you, my brother. We will catch up on Tuesday.
Have a good one, Big O.
You got it. There you go. The great Saffid Dean. Yes, our baptisthealth.net/ortho. Miami Dolphins post-game report. And when it comes...
This is the Big O Show.